Okay, great. Can you hear me with this, hopefully? Great. Well, shout if you can't hear me at some point. So thanks for the introduction. I'm going to try and hopefully follow Frank's approach, maybe even be slightly more elementary. So the lecture notes, which are linked on the website, have a reasonably complete proof of some kind of modularity lifting theorem in a way that's written in a way that extends to the kind of modularity lifting theorems we know for GLN. So if you want to see how that's done, you can look in those notes. But in this lecture, and these lectures, I'm not planning to really go through that proof in any detail, but more to talk about the background, to talk about what the theorems actually are and why we want to prove them. So I apologize to any experts, any people who've already read the notes in detail. There's hopefully going to be still some insight here, but let's see. So the first thing I want to talk about is Galois representations. So I want to start just by saying what these are and giving some examples. So Frank already stole the first examples for me, but let's start with taking Q, the rationals, and then Q bar, some algebraic closure. And then I'm going to write GQ for the absolute Galois group of Q, so the Galois group of Q bar over Q. And more generally, if F is a number field, I'll write GF for the absolute Galois group of F. Okay, in fact, these are, so the first definition of a Galois representation is just a representation of a Galois group. So I'm just going to say maybe a representation of some kind that I'll make more precise in a little while of GQ or G. So I want to consider representations of these groups. Well, in fact, I'm naturally going to be led to considering some representations of some related groups. So if I fix an embedding of Q bar into the algebraic closure of the periodic numbers QP, that gives me then a map from the Galois, the absolute Galois group of QP to GQ. And maybe I'm going to call this the obvious thing. Maybe I'll call this GQP. And I call this guy a decomposition group. OK, so then given representation, maybe I'll call my representation rho, and all my representations are actually going to be finite dimensional. So maybe I'll value it in some field, what's a good name for a field, maybe K. Then restriction gives, if I can just restrict to a decomposition group, this is just a subgroup. Get a representation like this. So that's not so good. Is that about right? Great. Okay, so the aim, what I want to do, at least today, is, and in general, the point of this part of the course is to kind of study such representations perhaps of GQ, but more generally these GF, and their restrictions to these decomposition subgroups.
restrictions to the various GQP. Okay, so let's see an example. So why do we actually care about these things at all? So Frank gave you one hint, which is that we're going to care about them because they tell us things about modular forms. And I think that's going to be perhaps the main point of why Gal representations will be useful for Frank's course. For this one, it's more the opposite perspective. It's going to be we're interested in Gal representations themselves for their own right, and we want to see what modular forms can tell us about them. So let's take a very simple example. So let's fix P, maybe an odd prime number. And then let's consider the quadratic extension Q of root P over Q. So this is ramified at P and possibly ramified at 2, depending on whether P is plus or minus 1 mod 4. So then I can build a representation in the following way. I'm going to build a one-dimensional representation. So I take GQ, which is this Gower group of Q bar over Q, and then I restrict to this extension here, and then I can identify this group here with plus or minus 1. So the point is that this group here is the group of automorphisms of Q bar, and any such automorphism preserves Q of root P, subfield, and that Gower group is just of order 2, so I can naturally identify it with the group plus or minus 1. So I've just got a character, GQ, to plus or minus 1, one-dimensional quadratic representation. Okay, so going back to the top of the page, I want to study this representation. I want to study its restrictions to decomposition groups. So I have to be a little careful. I've used P in sort of two different ways now, so let's have a different prime. So let's take... It's probably going to be endemic in my lectures. I'm going to make unfortunate choices of primes. But let's take L a prime other than 2 or P so that this extension is unramified at L. So the prime L is either split or inert in this extension, but not ramified. So then we have a canonical element from L in this Gower group. Which just lifts the mod L Frobenius. So we can try and compute what this representation is doing on this Frobenius element. So chi of Frobel is going to be plus or minus 1, just because every element of the Gower group is centered either plus or minus 1. And which is it? So when is it plus 1? Well, chi of a Frobenius element at L is plus 1, precisely if this Frobenius element fixes root P. It's an automorphism of Q root P. It's determined by what it does to root P. So that's the same as saying that root P to the L is root P. This is in kind of FL bar, if you like, in characteristic L. And that's the same as saying that square root of P is actually an element of the base field FL. So
solutions to the equation x to the L equals x in characteristic L are just the elements of the base finite field. That's because by Fermat's little theorem, they certainly all are roots, and you only have at most L roots just by counting. So this is true if and only if P is a quadratic residue mod L, just by definition. So what this says is, if I can write my Legendre symbols the correct way up, I think this says chi of rho L is this symbol. Do correct me if I get this wrong. Okay, so this Gal representation has some arithmetic content. It's telling us about quadratic residues. So now the kind of great thing you can do, and the thing that we want to generalize, the thing I want to talk about for the rest of this course, is we can compute this in another way. So let's make an assumption. Let's assume that P is 1 mod 4. Okay, well then, this is the case when this extension Q root P over Q, it's now not ramified at 2. So it's only ramified at P. And it's actually the unique quadratic field with that property. Well, on the other hand, if we consider the extension Q zeta p over Q, where now zeta p, this is a primitive pth root of unity. This extension is also ramified only at p. For example, it's not very hard to compute the discriminant of this extension and see it's just a power of p. And is actually Galois, the Galois group. That over here, so you probably all know the Galois group, Q, C to P on Q, is just Z mod PZ star, where we identify the element that takes Cp to its zeta p to its eighth power. This gets identified with A mod p. So certainly the automorphisms of this field have to take a pth root of unity to another pth root of unity. They're all powers, so you get some identification. So in particular, this is cyclic of even order. So just by elementary Galois theory, Q zeta p over Q, this has some intermediate quadratic extension which is ramified only at p. So it contains quadratic field only ramified at p. And since I already said what that is, that says that Q of root p is contained in Q of zeta p. Of course, there are other ways to prove this. Okay, so now I'm going to use that to compute my character in another way. So now I can think of chi. Instead of restricting all the way down to Q root P, I could restrict first of all to the Galois group of Q zeta P over Q, then restrict from there to Gal Q root P over Q, which we're identifying with plus or minus 1.
And this group here we're identifying with Z mod PZ. So I can think of this as just being a character like this. Okay.
But now there's going to be another way to describe this character because,
I mean, now I can see everything in some sense because this group here is cyclic and I'm just mapping it down to plus minus one and this character is now uniquely determined. So this group is cyclic. So chi is the kind of unique non-trivial character, non-trivial quadratic character of this group. And the kernel of chi, thought of as a character of this, is just the squares. So it's just the, if you like, just the quadratic residues. In Z mod.
Okay, so what I wanted to do is I wanted to compute chi on Frobenius elements. So now it's easy to check that Frobenius at L on zeta p does exactly the only thing it could really do. It has to raise it to some power, and it's supposed to be lifting the Lth power map mod L. So it just takes zeta p to its Lth power. Okay? So Frob L gets mapped to L mod P in Z mod PZ star. Unfortunately, I'm not still going to have that sheet over there. Maybe I'm going to do the very bad thing of just not putting this up again for 2 seconds where I just write something else. Maybe I'll put it back and then I'll do some reveal. Sorry. Okay, so what that says, what I've just written there, says that chi of Frob L is equal to 1 if and only if L is a quadratic residue mod P. So we see since it's a quadratic character, we just have that it's equal to this Legendre symbol here. But then earlier on, we had that it was equal to this other Legendre symbol, P on L.
And so we have these two symbols are equal.
Okay. So this is somewhere close to half of quadratic reciprocity, if you like.
So the exercise is to prove the rest of quadratic reciprocity in the same way. So in other words, to consider the case that P is minus 1 mod 4, or indeed that P is 2. You can prove both of those cases in an entirely analogous fashion. Okay, so
the idea of that example is to show you, hopefully, that Gal representations can encode information that's of interest to number theorists. In fact, I think Gal representations always encode information of interest to number theorists.
So the aim of what I want to talk about is to generalize this. So to think a little about what I mean here. I mean, in some sense, these are the absolute simplest Gal representations you could imagine, because quadratic characters are about as simple as it gets. Characters are as simple as it gets, and then the simplest, the trivial character is never going to tell you anything very interesting, arguably.
So these are the simplest next thing. Of course, you can also do this with other quadratic fields and see what information comes out. So the next thing you might want to do is just do the case of general characters. But then what we really want to talk about, what I really want to talk about, is the case of higher dimensional representations. So what did I do? What am I trying to really generalize? So we started with the Gal representation. And we observed that when we looked at its restrictions to decomposition groups, when we looked at it locally, it encoded some arithmetic information. So that was originally the information about P being a square model or not. It encoded some arithmetic information. And then we then computed the local information in terms of something else. And we drew some conclusions. So this second step is a little more obscure the way I've written this, because in some sense, I mean, the weird thing about quadratic reciprocity is there's really an exact symmetry. There's this P and this L, and I get this exact correspondence. But when we're going to generalize it in a minute and look at high dimensional representations, we're not going to get such a symmetry. And so really at the moment, it's slightly hidden exactly what this computation I'm alluding to here is, this computation I did by realizing this quadratic field inside a cyclotomic field. So let me show you an example of kind of what happens for a two-dimensional representation, give you some more of idea. Well, Frank has already sort of shown us one example, but let me show you it again, and that will maybe give you a better sense of how the symmetry is being broken. So let's look at this guy. So Q times the product. So I'm going to write a Fourier expansion in modular form in terms of an infinite product. 1 minus Q to the n squared, 1 minus Q to the 11n squared. So this is if Q is e to the 2 pi I z, then this is an eigenform of weight 2, I guess level gamma naught of 11. And if I expand this out a little, I hopefully get something like Q minus 2Q squared minus Q cubed, 2q to the 4. Now I'm at the mercy of my handwriting, which is not great. I guess you're at the mercy of it as well, so. Minus 2q to the 9, minus 2q to the 10, q to the 11, minus 2q to the 12, 4, q to the 13, plus blah, blah, blah. Okay. So this is some sequence of, I seem to have got 112 as a coefficient there. We don't really want that. I mean, for all I know, there is a coefficient of minus 2 at q to 112. I'm sure someone can disprove that quickly. Okay, so here's some integers. And then here's something else. Here's an elliptic curve. So not quite in the form that Frank was writing them in earlier, where it was y squared as a cubic with no quadratic term. But of course, you can rearrange this in those terms. Let's look at this elliptic curve, and let's do a quick table with some prime numbers and a count of the number of points mod p. Don't worry, I'm not going to work these out in real time. I could do, but I would overrun and not get very far, I suspect. Okay, so let's do 2, 3, 5, 7. I'm going to skip 11. 13, 17, dot, 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 dot. These ones I've written down. So that seems, if you do the calculation, well, p is 2 is pretty easy. You can definitely do that one in your heads. And the rest of these are a bit more work, perhaps.
And now I want to subtract the one from the other, and I get minus 2, minus 1, 1, minus 2, 4, minus 2. And if I've successfully copied off the paper twice, what you see is that these numbers here are going to be the coefficients up here. So these numbers are the coefficients. All these numbers in this bottom line are the coefficients in the product expansion above.
Okay, so what this says is that this is an example of this elliptic curve being modular. So the statement that E is modular and I didn't give my modular form a name. Maybe I should, I was resisting giving it a name, but maybe I'm going to call it F corresponding. So something similar is true for any elliptic curve over Q. If you did a calculation like this, note that I left out 11. So 11 is the unique prime where this elliptic curve has bad reduction. But if you write down any elliptic curve over Q, and you ignore the finitely many primes of bad reduction, then you can do this thing of counting the points over FP, subtracting that number from P, and the remarkable thing is that that gives you the coefficients of some eigenform. Okay, so my claim is that that's going to be an example of the kind of generalization of quadratic reciprocity that I want to write down in terms of Galois representations. But to justify that claim, at the moment, I don't have a Galois representation. I have a list of numbers for prime numbers p. What I want is some kind of Galois representation. So where is this representation? The answer is, it comes from the elliptic curve. The answer the action of GQ on the torsion points of the elliptic curve. So the point about elliptic curves, they're not just curves. They naturally have a group law on them. So for any integer n at least 1, let's let En be the set of n torsion points of E. So I'm just thinking, obviously I'm over Q at the moment, but I'm thinking if I instead think about points defined over, say, the complex numbers or just over Q bar, I can then ask if those points are n-torsion or not. And thinking about it as a complex curve, thinking about it as just an elliptic curve as just being the complex plane modulo some lattice, as Frank was, it's then easy to see that as an abelian group, this is just isomorphic to Z mod NZ squared in an abelian group. Not canonically, but after choosing some basis. And because the group law is purely an algebraic thing, then finding the coordinates of these points is a matter of solving polynomial equations with rational coefficients. So the coordinates of points in EN are certainly algebraic. They're in Q bar. So we get an action of this Galois group on this N torsion. And after using that isomorphism, we get a representation, as it were, at least a homomorphism to GL2 Z mod NZ. Do we
we talk about representations of value? Yeah, I guess we did. I was wondering if we could value them in rings, but of course we can. Okay, so that's a Gal representation. So what does that have to do with the numbers over there and with the modular form? Then it's a fact, and it's not so hard to check from this definition that if L doesn't divide, if L is not equal to 11 in this case, then what do I want to call this? I should give this guy a name. Let's call it rho sub E. Then rho E is unramified at L. So the inertia at L acts trivially. Or if you like, the extension being cut out is unramified at L. And the connection with the numbers above is that the trace of a Frobenius element L is equal to AL. I guess mod n, since my Gal representation is mod n. Okay, so now we have a link. So now this Gal representation here, these ALs are the thing I didn't define up there because I never gave a general matter. Let's give this AM q to the n. Sorry. So these ALs are just these numbers here. Okay? So of course, this is what you really, to prove this fact here, I mean, the fact, as I've stated it, that it's related to these numbers, this modular form is deep. That's using the modularity of this elliptic curve. But the fact that those numbers are the same as the last line of this table is a much more elementary thing. Everything there is just some calculation in the geometry. Okay, so I should also say that this information, I mean, it might seem like I'm writing down something a little random. I'm writing down, on the one side, I'm just telling you what the coefficients are at prime numbers of the Fourier expansion. And on the Galois side, I'm just telling you the traces of some particular Frobenius elements. But in fact, those pieces of information on each side are enough to define the things uniquely. So F is actually determined by knowledge of the ALs, because it's an eigenform. And similarly, rho E turns out to be determined up to isomorphism. I can spell isomorphism by these traces as well. So this uses that the Frob L, I guess in this case for L not equals 11, these are dense in the Gower group, which is a consequence of the Chebotarov density theorem. Okay, so this really is some dictionary, some correspondence. I've got a Gower representation on the one side, and it's determined by this data about traces Frobenii being equal to particular things. And on the other side, I have this modular form, which again is being dictated by these numbers. So this is what I'm now regarding as some generalization of quadratic reciprocity. So I've gone from having a Gal representation valued in plus minus one to something more sophisticated, something two-dimensional. And then I've gone from describing it in terms of some the Legendre symbol to describing it in terms of the coefficients of some modular form. And this is much closer to how the picture is in general. In great generality, you expect some quite large class of n-dimensional Gal representations to be described in terms of Hecker eigenvalues of automorphic forms. Okay, well, what I want to do next is move towards actually making that into a kind of precise general statement. So the first thing to do is that, I mean, usually when we consider representations of groups, we tend to consider representations perhaps with complex coefficients. And here I've got coefficients in Z mod NZ, which is maybe not such a nice thing to have in comparison to the complex numbers in general. Now, unfortunately, we can't just massage this in some way to get a representation value in the complexes, but we can get something a little nicer than we currently have by considering what happens if we have this modulo each integer n at the moment, we can kind of compile those together in some nice way. So let's consider all of these representations simultaneously. Consider them all at once. Well, the first observation is that they're compatible in a kind of nice standard way. If I replace n with some multiple, I kind of get more information, and I can get the original information back by just going back to mod n again. So I can put them together in some kind of projective system. And by the Chinese remainder theorem, it's basically enough to understand what happens as I go up a p-power tower. So enough to consider, to understand how these fit together, it's going to be enough to consider how they fit together the case where n is kind of running over p to the r with r at least 1. Then the ones with different primes I'll get together just by taking a product. And then so then the representations compile together. To give a representation, which I'm going to call rho EP from GQ to GL2 of the limit of the Z mod P to the Rs, which is just GL2 of CP. So what's naturally coming out of this construction, naturally coming out of the geometry, is a p-adic representation, a representation valued in GL2 of ZP. And it's an exercise. You can check that this is continuous with respect to the natural topologies here, which are the profinite topology on GQ. So GQ is also a limit. It's just the limit you get over the Galois groups of finite extensions, and that naturally has a topology. And then, of course, you have the p-adic topology. Okay, so now let's consider all of the rho EP as P varies. So if I do that, I get quite different representations, because the topology on the p-adic numbers and the l-adic numbers for p not equal to l are completely different. So I don't get some situation where I have my p-adic representation and the l-adic representation some easy way to move between them, because they're topologically completely different guys. But on the other hand, you can see this equation here is still going to be satisfied. But I wonder, this wasn't, I should have written what was in my notes. This shouldn't divide 11n. Sorry, it's exactly what it says in my notes, and I couldn't see an n when I was writing it. So I'm still going to have equations like this as this varies, but I'm not going to have some easy way to move between the representations. So I get what I call, let me try and system more precise, we get a compatible system . So that can be an important notion, a compatible system, or also gets called a compatible family of Galois representations. Representations are going from rho EP from GQ GL2 ZP. And the compatible thing means
there's a common ramification set to these things. So this is going to be the set 11. So in the sense that if L is not equal to 11 or P, then rho EP is unramified at L. And more than that, the trace from L is independent of the choice of P not equal to 11 or L. So let's just remark, I mean, that's certainly the case in the representation we're considering, because in our cases this number is just this AL. It has nothing to do with the choice of P. So in particular, this trace of this Frobenius element, by definition, this is just a number in ZP. It's a p-adic number. But it's actually, for this statement to make any sense at all, it actually has to land in the integers. Okay, because I can't compare p-adic and l-adic numbers unless they're actually integers. They're just not in the same universe. So these properties came about very naturally when we just wrote this example down. It is very easy to write down this Gal representation. And on the other hand, if you imagine that you didn't have this idea of using some geometry in some way, if I asked you to write down a system of representations like this, you might well struggle a great deal. Because it's, as I say, it's not at all obvious how you would take a p-adic representation and an l-adic representation and go from one to the other or glue them together in some way like this. And in fact, I've already said that the p-adic representation was determined by these traces of Frobenius. So in fact, given just one of these representations for one prime p, all the other ones are going to have to be uniquely determined. But there's no obvious way of producing them. Okay, it's like you can say, if they're there, then I know they're uniquely determined. But actually showing they're there is another matter. And in fact, it's not the case in general that if I just write down a random two-dimensional p-adic representation of GQ, that there will be a compatible system in this way. There are plenty of representations which don't live in those kind of compatible systems. So the property of being in a compatible system is very restrictive. So conjecturally, if I have a Gal representation which is part of a compatible system, I have a compatible system of Gal representations, the conjecture is it basically has to arise essentially in the way that I've just been showing you. I'll make this more precise tomorrow. So it implies that the representations come from geometry in some sense. So in this case, the representation came from geometry because we built it from just looking at torsion points on an elliptic curve. And they also have to come from automorphic forms. And in this case, the automorphic forms in question were just these modular forms. So the kind of aim of modularity lifting theorems, if you like, is roughly speaking, very roughly speaking, to show that that Gal representations do indeed
automorphic forms. And in some cases, you can then deduce that they come from geometry. I say in some cases, because actually in many cases, the most important applications of these theorems are where you take some Galois representations that you know come from geometry, like these ones coming from an elliptic curve, and then you deduce that they come from automorphic forms, but then you're not going to deduce whether they came from geometry because they came from geometry in the first place.
So the prototypical example of this is what I was talking about to start with. It's taking an elliptic curve over Q, looking at its associated Galois representations, proving those come from a modular form. So that was the Taniyama-Shimura conjecture. And that was the proof of the Taniyama-Shimura conjecture is what these modularity lifting theorems were invented for. So I think I'm at the right point to stop for today, and I'll continue tomorrow by making this more precise. Thank you.